From my blood come the prince that was promised, and his will be the song I see fire.
With the pursuit of power on the rise, and the perilous and intricate world of Westeros, where power games are played and betrayal leaks beyond each corner.
But that wasn't one of them.
Oh, but it was. When you play the Game of Thrones, you win or you die. There is no middle ground.
Honor lurks as a beacon, a testament of character.
King Robert is dead. I've been searching for you, Daenerys Stormborn, to ask your forgiveness. I was sworn to protect your family. I failed them. I am Barristan Selmy, Kingsguard to your father. Allow me to join your Queen's Guard, and I will not fail you again.
Amidst the treacherous walls of King's Landing, where dragons once soared and whispers of rebellion echo through the halls of power, the clash between justice and duty and treachery shapes the fate of all.
May I see that letter, Sir Barristan? Protector of the realm. Is this meant to be your shield, Lord Stark? It's of paper.
Honor is the thread that weaves through the fabric of our society, binding together laws, customs, oaths, and loyalty. The complex interplay shapes the destiny of characters and the fate of the realm itself. The primary structure of governance within Westeros is the feudal system, where various lords and their vassals owe allegiance to the king. This hierarchy helps to maintain order, as each level of society is responsible for maintaining stability and forcing laws within their own domain.
Robert of the House Baratheon, the first of his name. I, Eddard, the House Stark, Lord of Winterfell and Warden of the North.
The central authority on the Iron Throne is located in King's Landing. The king is supposed to unify the seven kingdoms of Westeros in one rule. This was made precedent with Aegon Targaryen, as he forged the seven kingdoms, uniting them together as one with his sister wives, Rhaenys and Visenya. On the back of their dragons, they conquered the seven kingdoms and united them together besides Dorne. With the kingdom forged together, Aegon and Valerion forged the Iron Throne. The king, with the help of his council, enforces laws, collects taxes, and oversees the realm's discourse. The major noble families, such as the Stark, Lannisters, Baratheons, and even Tyrells, and other interconnected houses, play a critical role in maintaining order within their various territories.
That leaves the Tyrells.
Lannister, Targaryen, Baratheon, Stark, Tyrell. They're all just spokes on a wheel. This one's on top, then that one's on top, and on it spins, crushing those on the ground.
It's a beautiful dream. Stopping the wheel. You're not the first person who's ever dreamt it.
I'm not going to stop the wheel. I'm going to break the wheel.
These houses act as a regional power known as wardens, binding the force of the crown and jurisdictioning laws of power and customs.
My father was Micah, the first of his name. My brother Egan reigned after him when I had refused the throne, and he was followed by his son Aerys, whom they called the Mad King.
You're Aemon Targaryen.
I am a Maester of the Citadel, bound in service to Castle Black and the Night's Watch.
Another sacred tradition that is bounded not only by blood and precedent is the Brotherhood Beyond the Wall. The swords of the Brotherhood guard the wall in the north, protecting the realm amongst external threats such as wildlings or the White Walkers known as the Others. This serves as a line of defense against chaos beyond the Wall itself. The dominant religion within Westeros is known as the Faith of the Seven, providing moral and ethical guidance to the people. The church is leaded by a High Sparrow, wielding special influence and can be used to maintain society, order, and stability within the religion domain.
The emblems of the Seven serve only to guide us on an uncertain path, to remind us of a higher authority.
Similarly, the Order of the Scholars, known as the Masons, are supposed to help provide wisdom to their counterparts and successors, known as kings or wardens. They are known as healers and advisors. The Maesters control the stability of the realm through their knowledge and expertise that they are founded within the Maester of the Citadel to make links and advise kings on various decisions. With the Brotherhood, or the Sept, which is guarded by the Faith of the Seven, these external forces help to solidify the realm itself, but not only instill the devotion of an oath, understanding that these groups of people must take sacred oaths and vows that will be upholded to something beyond oneself. Similarly, when you are sworn in as a Kingsguard, you revoke lands, titles, and being able to father a child.
I swear to ward the queen with all my strength and give my blood for hers. I shall take no wife, hold no lands, father no children. I shall guard her secrets, obey her commands, ride at her side and defend her name and honor.
With this sacred oath comes the upholdance to serve the crown itself. These oaths are a testament to the society of Westeros. Deeply ingrained customs, traditions, and social norms help regulate behavior and maintain a sense of order amidst the chaos. Duty, honor, and loyalty are highly valued, especially amongst the nobility. For instance, Jaime Lannister upholds Ned Stark's honor as some sort of ego, judgment placed on each other so that Ned doesn't have to look in the own mirror. This instance is so opposite to me when it's quite reversed in the shoes of Jaime. He feels that he's better than everyone else, and he gives himself a sense of entitlement.
What gods are those, Lady Catelyn? The trees your husband prayed to? How well did they serve him when my sister took his head off? Jaime gave a chuckle. If there are gods, why is the world so full of pain and injustice? Because of men like you. There are no men like me. There's only me. There is nothing here but arrogance and pride, and the empty courage of a madman. I'm wasting my breath with this one.
Ned feels that you have to earn everything that you want in this world. With many rulers in Westeros having the pursuit of legacy and believing that fear and blood keeps order amidst the chaos, the realm will bleed.
Honor? I've got seven kingdoms to rule! One king, seven kingdoms! Do you think honor keeps them in line? Do you think it's honor that's keeping the peace? It's fear! Fear and blood!
Then we're no better than the Mad King.
A good leader does not rule for the pursuit of a legacy or one's power, but instead for what's best for their people. As a leader that is noble and honorable is not of oneself. To understand this, one must look past their own desires and seek out what is best for the realm itself.
Give me the wisdom to see the path ahead and the strength to do what I must do to keep my children safe. The guards did not respond. When she opened her eyes again, Daenerys said, I cannot fight two enemies, one within and one without. If I am to hold Meereen, I must have the city behind me, the whole city. I need... She could not say it. Your Grace, Sir Barristan prompted, gently. A queen belongs not to herself, but to her people.
Figures like Brianna Tarth, Sansa Stark, Aegon V, known as Aeg, and Sir Barristan Selmy rise as a beacon of honor, steadfast in their commitment of justice, duty, and loyalty. Brianna unwaveringly pursues her knightly vows. Sansa gracefully underscores the pursuit of legacy. Aegon V's just reign shows how much a king can love his people. And Barristan Selmy, unspoken loyalty to the crown and to pursue the Targaryen reign, is untimeless virtue that will show the realm a beacon of steadfast strength. In contrast, those characters like Aerys Targaryen, known as the Mad King, Tywin Lannister, Jaime Lannister, and Peter Baelish show the darker results of corruption, oath breaks, and loyalty that is twisted to their own selfish ends. As we dive into the intricate tapestry of Westerosi norms, this will uncover how noble pursuits of honor, rooted in justice, duty, oaths, and loyalty, stand in stark opposition of the corrosive forces of betrayal and ambition through the lives of those who have honored their vows and those who shatter them. We will explore the powerful impact of those ideas that will either make the realm flourish or destroy it entirely. Honor is deeply intertwined with multi-interfaceted groups regarding justice and duty. The first thing that we will take a look on is how justice and duty often demands a specific self-sacrifice.
I have to believe that in the end, honor and decency will prevail.
Preferring one's duty over their own personal beliefs or their personal accomplishment.
Because it's your duty as queen to crush rebellion.
You know my oath reaches beyond our personal ambitions. A Song of Ice and Fire.
Oftentimes, in the world of A Song of Ice and Fire, one must give up their own desires to fulfill an accomplishment that is bigger than themselves. With the idea of justice and duty granting honor to those around them, this recurring theme shapes the narrative of different characters' development throughout A Song of Ice and Fire series as a whole. Brianna of Tarth is a good example at the sense of justice and duty within Westeros, especially when she has pledged her loyalty to King Renly Baratheon and Lady Catelyn Stark.
Your Grace, I ask the honor of a place in your Kingsguard, yours, and keep you safe from all harm.
Brianna never unwavers through her duty and quest for justice on both Renly's death and Catelyn's death. Renly Baratheon, who declared himself king and gathered the support of the Stormlanders and the men of the Reach, was murdered by a shadow assassin conjured by Melisandre under the orders of Stannis Baratheon, his own brother.
A shadow is a thing of darkness. You are more ignorant than the child, Sir Knight. There are no shadows in the dark. Shadows are the servants of light, the children of fire. The brightest flame casts the darkest shadows.
Although Stannis Baratheon did not kill Renly, his own brother, by his own hands, it still makes him culpable. During the depiction of the shadow figure through Catelyn's POV, she does say that the shadow looks remarkably like Stannis. I believe that has something to do with the fact that Melisandre and Stannis made the shadow thing together, and it also plays on Stannis's conscience.
I was there when he was murdered by a shadow with your face. You murdered him with blood magic.
I did.
After the events happen, Stannis has bad nightmares and is unable to get away from the dramatic occurrence that took place with the murder of his own brother. This could also tie in with the superstition that if you kill your own blood, your own flesh and blood, you will be cursed by the gods. The act of kinslaying is extremely taboo within Westerosi custom. Witnessing this horrific event, Brienne vows to avenge Renly's death. Her unwavering pursuit of justice and revenge for killing Renly results in her killing Stannis in the TV adaptation.
In the name of Renly of House Baratheon, first of his name,
rightful king of the Andals and the First Men, lord of the Seven Kingdoms and protector of the realm, I, Brienne of Tarth, sentence you to die. Do you have any last words?
Go on, do your duty.
This act satisfies her vows and relieves her from her duty as his Kingsguard. After Renly's death, she pledges her service to Lady Catelyn Stark, who entrusts her in the mission of finding her daughters and protecting them, Sansa and Arya Stark.
Then I am yours, my lady. I will shield your back and give my life for yours if it comes to that. I swear it by the old gods and the new.
This mission demonstrates Brienne's steadfast commitment to her vows. Despite numerous attempts within her own life, challenges, including being captured and nearly killed multiple times, Brienne persists within her quest.
I will find her, my lady, Brienne swore to Lady Catelyn's restless shade. I will never stop looking. I will give up my life if need be. Give up my honor, give up my dreams, but I will find her.
And her determination to her duty is a testament to her honor, as she continues to fulfill her promise to Catelyn Stark even after Catelyn's untimely departure. Now, at least within the books, this happens a little bit differently within the TV show. Catelyn does come back as Lady Stoneheart, and she does run across Brienne. This exchange is met with hostility, as Lady Stoneheart has lost almost nearly everything and has lost a piece of herself that is indescribable.
The woman in grey gave no answer. She studied the sword, the parchment, the bronzen iron crown. Finally, she reached up under her jaw and grasped her neck, as if she meant to throttle herself. Instead, she spoke. Her voice was halting, broken, tortured. The sound seemed to come from her throat, part croak, part wheeze, part death rattle. The language of the damned, thought Brienne. I don't understand. What did she say? She asked the name of this blade of yours, said the young Northman in his sheepskin jerkin. Oathkeeper, Brienne answered. The woman in grey hissed through her fingers. Her eyes were two red pits burning in the shadows. She spoke again. No, she says. Call it Oathbreaker, she says. It was made for treachery and murder. She names it False Friend, like you.
She says that Brienne does not hold up her oath and did not protect her children, and because of this, she wants Brienne to kill Jaime Lannister. Now, it is unsure and unclear if Brienne will hold up to this oath as well. Another great example of someone having a great sense of justice and duty is Brandon Stark, also known as Brandon the Builder. He epitomizes duty and his legacy, often safeguarding the North. His monumental efforts on building and constructing the Wall and Winterfell.
I could tell you a story about Brandon the Builder, old Ned said. That was always your favorite.
Thousands and thousands of years ago, Brandon the Builder had razed Winterfell, and some said the Wall.
Underscores his unwavering commitment to those of the realm and his people of the North for generations to come. Brandon the Builder is credited with the construction of the Wall, a massive, formidable wall that is on the farther north of Westeros.
The largest structure ever built by the hands of man, Benjen Stark had told Jon on the King's Road when they had first caught sight of the Wall in the distance. You could see it from miles off, a pale blue line across the northern horizon, stretching away to the east and west and vanishing in the far distance, immense and unbroken. This is the end of the world.
The Wall stands as a colossal barrier, the threats posed by the White Walkers and other dangers lurking beyond the Wall. Constructed from ice and magic, it stretches 300 miles long and 700 feet high.
The sun had broken through the clouds. He turned his back on it and lifted his eyes to the wall, blazing blue and crystalline in the sunlight. Even after all these weeks, the sight of it still gave him the shivers.
A testament to the ingenuity and capability of Brandon and his legacy. Brandon the Builder is deeply intertwined with the values of duty and protection within generations to come. His efforts laid the foundation for the enduring power and influence of House Stark. The Wall and Winterfell are not mere archetypal feasts, but they represent that inherit the North are safeguarded within internal threats and external threats. In contrast, figures like Cersei Lannister or Aerys Targaryen, known as the Mad King, highlight the perversions of these ideas. Their actions underscore how corruption of justice and duty can lead to tyranny and chaos, destroying the realm and creating havoc amongst the people. Cersei Lannister's quest for power undertakes the ruthless and manipulation, a blatant disregard for justice, unlike Brianna Tarth and Brandon the Builder, whose actions are driven by a sense of honor and duty to the realm. Cersei's motivations are deeply intertwined with self-preservation and the consolidation of power. Her schemes include the framing and execution of political rivals, the manipulation of the Faith of the Seven, and using violence as a means to get what she wants. This results in suffering beyond our comprehension, kicking off the War of the Five Kings. Tywin states it the best. He doesn't distrust Cersei because she's a woman. He distrusts her because she's not as smart as she thinks.
His sister liked to think of herself as Lord Tywin with teats, but she was wrong. Their father has been as relentless and implacable as a glacier when Cersei was all wildfire, especially when thwarted. She had been giddy as a maiden when she learned that Stannis had abandoned Dragonstone, certain that he had finally given up the fight and sailed away to exile. When word came down from the north that he had turned up again at the wall, her fury had been fearful to behold. She does not lack for wits, but she has no judgment and no patience.
Cersei's involvement in the death of her husband, King Robert Baratheon, and the death of Ned Stark sets off a chain reaction leading to the War of the Five Kings. Her action demoralizes a willing to betray those closest to her just for the sake of power.
Knowledge is power.
Seize him. Cut his throat. Stop. Wait. I've changed my mind. Let him go. Step back 3 paces. Turn around. Close your eyes. Power.
One of the most egregious examples of this disgusting pursuit of legacy deeply entrenched within Cersei Lannister is the fact that her children are not even of Robert's blood.
Do you, Lord Stark? Is that why you called me here to pose me riddles?
Has he done this before?
Jaime would have killed him. My brother's worth 1,000 of your friend.
Your brother? Or your lover?
Targaryens wed brothers and sisters for 300 years to keep bloodlines pure. Jaime and I are more than brother and sister. We shared a womb. Came into this world together, we belong together.
Cersei and Jaime Lannister have a relationship together. Jaime Lannister is Cersei's twin brother. Cersei and Jaime's incestual relationship results in the birth of Cersei's children, Joffrey, Tommen, and Marcella. This secret, kept around the Red Keep, is first discovered by Jon Arryn. Once he finds out, he is subsequently disposed of. Hands of the king begin to drop like flies. Ned Stark also learns this secret, and at the time, Robert Baratheon is subsequently injured by a bull. And because of this, he is unable to adequately deal with the situation at hand in a respectable manner. Another demonstration of Cersei grasping onto power is when she has the Tower of the Hand set on fire, just because she believes her little brother, Tyrion, is hiding within the walls of the Tower of the Hand. Now, she believes that Tyrion murdered her firstborn son, Joffrey Baratheon, who was king at the time of his death. Cersei truly believes that Tyrion killed her son because he states,
"I have never liked you, Cersei. But you were my own sister, so I never did you harm. You've ended that. I will hurt you for this. I don't know how yet, but give me time. A day will come when you think yourself safe and happy, and suddenly your joy will turn to ashes in your mouth, and you'll know the debt is paid."
When there comes a time where you think you are happy and safe, your happiness will turn to ashes in your mouth. Because of this one quote, she believes that he planned the death of her own son, his nephew. This act of treason results in the death of numerous innocent people, including political rivals, many people of the faith, and other people that she weaponizes and uses for power. Because Cersei's lust for power, and because she thinks that she can politically outmaneuver her enemies, most people compare her to Aerys Targaryen.
Cersei is as gentle as King Maegor, as selfless as Aegon the Unworthy, as wise as Mad Aerys. She never forgets a slight, real or imagined. She takes caution for cowardice and dissent for defiance, and she is greedy. Greedy for power, for honor, for love.
Known as the Mad King, fans and theorists online also consider the possibility that Aerys Targaryen could be Cersei Lannister's true father. Although I do not believe this, the descent of Cersei's madness is quite similar to Aerys Targaryen, known as the Mad King.
Aerys Targaryen, the second of his name, was but 18 years of age when he ascended the Iron Throne, in 262 AC, upon the death of his father, Jaehaerys, after little more than 3 years of rule. A handsome youth, Aerys had fought gallantly in the Stepstones during the War of the Ninepenny Kings. Though not the most diligent of princes, nor the most intelligent, he had an undeniable charm that won him many friends. He was also vain, proud, and changeable, traits that made him easy prey for flatterers and lickspittles, but these flaws were not immediately apparent to most at the time of his ascension.
He loses the sight of his responsibilities and duty to uphold the realm, and his descent into madness underscores the tragedy that results into a rebellion that ends the Targaryen dynasty.
When the people rose in revolt against him, your father set their towns in castles aflame. He murdered sons in front of their fathers. He burned men alive with wildfire and laughed as they screamed. And his efforts to stamp out dissent led to a rebellion that killed every Targaryen, except two.
I'm not my father.
No, your grace. Thank the gods.
Now, I will note that Aerys wasn't always mad. He did go about certain things in the wrong way, but after being kept and tortured for so very long, his mental state wasn't adequate to be king anymore, and his descent to madness was inevitable. He was so scared of people betraying him, he would burn men alive with wildfire, laughing as they screamed, because he thought, truly, that they had betrayed him in his twisted, delusional way.
But the Mad King gave his enemies the justice he thought they deserved, and each time it made him feel powerful and right. Until the very end.
The Mad King, his infamous lines is burn them all. During Robert's rebellion, he thought that people were rising against him, which they were, and he wanted them all to burn. The peasants, the town folk, all of them. Because of this, he was thrown over, not fit to be king anymore, and the rebellion destroyed the Targaryen rule entirely. Aerys and Cersei both have the idea that you must have fear in your subjects for them to obey, and because of that, they lose sight of what honor and duty and self-sacrifice truly is. While characters like Brianna Tarth and Brandon Stark uphold the noble ideas of justice and duty, upholding their oaths till the very end. Although they are coming in a place of power and doing things that both fulfill them, that they are not hurting those in the process. Laws and customs within traditions. Laws and customs within Westeros are largely defined by the feudal system of local governance and the overarching authority that resides on the Iron Throne. The justice system is demoralized within the lord's power to assort justice in the king's name. The position of the right of gits and palos over the lands they are granted, and hanging people, arresting them, and exercising the law within the king's name is common practice. However, landed knights are required to exercise power from their liege lord. These principles are upholded by the figures like Maester Aemon and Sansa Stark, who embody the idea of nobility and respect for these norms. Maesters like Aemon declare themselves to the life of service and knowledge, taking oaths of celibacy and forsaking personal ambitions. Despite his royal lineage, Aemon chooses this path, embodying the customs of sacrifice and duty.
He was a good man, he began, but as soon as he had said the words, he knew that they were wrong. No, he was a great man, a maester of the citadel, chained and sworn brother of the Night's Watch. Ever faithful.
Sent to the Citadel at a young age due to the potential threat posed by too many Targaryen heirs, Aemon forged his chains by 19 years old and served at a lordling court. He later moved to Dragonstone, serving his brother as a trusted advisor. After Aemon's father's death, King Micah, a great council considered Aemon for the throne, but he refused, upholding his sacred vows and allowing his younger brother to become King Aegon V.
No man was wiser, or gentler, or kinder. At the wall, a dozen lords commander came and went during his years of service, but he was always there to counsel them. He counseled kings as well. He could have been a king himself, but when they offered him the crown, he told them they should give it to his younger brother. How many men would do that?
Aegon V was never truly supposed to be heir, and was dubbed Aegon the Unlikely. To avoid being a pawn in political plots, Aemon joined the Night's Watch. He commanded his duty and uphold his oath to the realm, unwavering, witnessing the fall of his own house during Robert's rebellion.
A lost relation, thousands of miles away. Useless. Dying.
Don't say that, Maester Aemon.
A Targaryen. Alone in the world. It's a terrible thing.
Aemon's life was fulfilled by the role of being a maester, to serve without ambitions or glory, upholding the customs of Westeros.
He was the blood of the dragon. But now his fire has gone out. And now his watch has ended.
And now his watch has ended.
In a similar situation, Sansa Stark is thrust in a challenging situation where she witnessed the own fall of her household and has to navigate the treacherous landscape of Westeros between duty to her own family and to her king as she's being held hostage in King's Landing.
Once she had loved Prince Joffrey with all her heart and admired and trusted his mother, the queen.
They had repaid that love and trust with her father's head. Sansa would never make that mistake again.
Despite her hardships, Sansa tries to uphold the values of her own house and tries to endure her wavering commitment within Joffrey's cruel reign of tyranny. An early testament of Sansa's loyalty occurs in the Ruby Red Fort, where her and Joffrey are walking and encounter her sister, Arya Stark, squabbling with a butcher's boy, Micah, where Joffrey gets injured with Nymeria, Arya's direwolf. It results in an untimely feud between Stark and Lannister. Sansa is put in the middle between her betrothed and her sister. This is the first time where we really see the unfortunate position that Sansa is truly in. In the aftermath, Sansa is torn between her loyalty to her house and her betrothed. Arya tells the truth to King Robert, while Joffrey lies, claiming the attack was on purpose. Sansa, unwilling to be brave and betray her future husband, declares that she does not remember. This reflects the complicated situation of loyalty and duty to one's family and the crown.
I don't know. I don't remember.
This also is foreshadowing how Sansa will later be torn between her family and her betrothed after Joffrey becomes king. Sansa's father, Eddard Stark, is arrested, accusing the king of being a bastard. Forced to call her own father a traitor to save her own life, Sansa pleads for mercy in front of Joffrey, which is now the king, in front of his court. Despite Joffrey's promising to be merciful, he orders the death and execution of Ned Stark, leaving Sansa helpless and dismayed. This incident underscores the brutality of Westerosi justice in the name of one's king. This also represents the idea that just because you call something justice doesn't necessarily prove that it is or if it is necessary. In contrast, figures like Robert Baratheon and Tywin Lannister represent a darker and more sinister approach to these customs. Their actions showcase how corrupt laws and traditions can lead to the descent of power and governance, watching the realm itself be marred by the decisions they are made. Robert Baratheon, once a heroic figure, usurped the throne from the Mad King, Aerys Targaryen, becoming king.
We had come late to Robert's cause. It was necessary to demonstrate our loyalty. When I laid those bodies before the throne, no man could doubt that we had forsaken House Targaryen forever, and Robert's relief was palpable. As stupid as he was, even he knew that Rhaegar's children had to die if his throne was ever to be secure. Yet he saw himself as a hero, and heroes do not kill children.
He abandoned his responsibilities to the crown and upholded the life of luxury, not necessarily being the best king. In the end, Robert's pursuit to end the Targaryen line leaves him in situations and acting no different than the Mad King he usurped.
He remembered the angry words they had exchanged when Tywin Lannister had presented Robert with the corpses of Rhaegar's wife and children as a token of fealty. Ned had named that murder. Robert called it war. When he had protested that the young prince and princess were no more than babes, his new-made king had replied, "I see no babes, only dragonspawn."
His neglect of kingship led to numerous issues. Robert's lavish spending and disregard for the realm plunged the realm itself and the crown in a deep debt. He loved and frequented tourneys, feasts, and personal expenses, draining the treasury, leaving the kingdom economically weakened. Robert's intention and inadequate to govern allowed powerful factions to form in his own court. His failure to address to such growing tensions between the Lannisters and the Starks, for example, set the stage for the War of the Five Kings. His inability to act, seizing the situations, resulted in numerous conflicts. Another example of a person disregarding the law and customs of Westeros is Tywin Lannister. He's a formidable leader who manipulates the laws and customs to further his ruthless pursuit of power. His actions, whether disputed, are especially heinous and lack moral ambiguity when he organizes the infamous Red Wedding.
Was it a soft silk pillow that slew Robb Stark? It was to be an arrow at Edmure Tully's wedding feast. The boy was too wary in the field. He kept his men in good order and surrounded himself with outriders and bodyguards. So Lord Walder slew him under his own roof, at his own table. Tyrion made a fist. What of Lady Catelyn?
Slain as well, I'd say. A pair of wolfskins. Frey had intended to keep her captive, but perhaps something went awry.
So much for guest right.
A brutal massacre of the Starks and Tully forces. He knew that he wouldn't be able to beat Robb at a battlefield, so slaughtering him in the rites of a guest house was the only way he could end him and the threat he posed to the kingdom. It exemplifies Tywin's willingness to implore any means necessary to achieve his own goal, regardless of the moral costs. During Robert's rebellion, Tywin initially maintained neutral standing, while later, when the rebellion looked as though it would succeed, he sacked King's Landing, and he forced his army on multiple massacres, including the death and murder of Princess Elia Martell and the death of her children.
His father shrugged. I grant you, it was done too brutally. Elia need not have been harmed at all. That was sheer folly. By herself, she was nothing.
Then why did the mountain kill her?
Because I did not tell him to spare her. Nor did I yet grasp what I had in Gregor Clegane. Only that he was huge and terrible in battle. The rape. Even you will not accuse me of giving that command, I would hope. Sir Aemry was almost as bestial with Rhaenys. I asked him afterwards why it had required 100 thrusts to kill a girl of 2, 3. He said she'd kicked him and would not stop screaming.
Tywin's actions not only instilled his family's position, but also instilled fear amongst the other lords and ladies. This pursuit of power was met by treachery with up the highest regard. Figures like Maester Aemon and Sansa Stark embody a positive reflection of Westerosi custom. Aemon's upholding his vows, both as a maester and as a member of the Night's Watch, reflect the nobility of duty and service. Sansa's resolve to maintain a steadfastness within her own personal and family values shows a strength of resilience even in times of hardship. Strength and honor and justice will prevail, even in moments of sadness or dismay. Robert and Tywin's negligence and ruthlessness embody the principles that will lead the realm in terror and chaos. This depicts the gross and dangerous ladder that one another gains for personal power, a warfare that will leave the realm in terror. Oaths are sacred bonds that define honor, duty, and loyalty. Those who belong to dynastic orders take explicitly religious vows. Even those who bond between secular lords and their vassals are typically backed by religious oaths. Oath breaking is a direct violation of an oath and a serious crime in Westeros. Most people who break oaths are typically looked down upon, and some are sentenced to death. A crime, but a sacrilege, breaking holy vows. Through this set of vows, a mixed more sacrosanct than others. Members of the Night's Watch, the Maesters, the Kingsguard, and religious orders of the Faith of the Seven all swear holy vows, promising a life of obedience obedience, chastity, and a reflection on any personal family ties of inheritance. Aegon V Targaryen, known affectionately as Aeg, exemplifies the nobility of Oes through his unwavering determination of his just rule and of his affectionate to his people of the realm. Ascending to the throne in 233 AC, Aegon immediately demonstrates his determination to just rule by arresting Brandon Rivers, the Hand of the King, for the murder of Aerys Blackfyre.
The first act of Aegon's reign was the arrest of Brandon Rivers, the King's Hand, for the murder of Aerys Blackfyre. Bloodraven did not deny that he had lured the pretender into his power by the offer of a safe conduct, but contended that he had sacrificed his own personal honour for the good of the realm. Though many agreed and were pleased to see another Blackfyre pretender removed, King Aegon felt he had no choice but to condemn the Hand, lest the word of the Iron Throne be seen as worthless. Yet after the sentence of death was pronounced, Aegon offered Bloodraven the chance to take the Black and join the Night's Watch.
Aegon V's kingship was marked by a fervent dedication to justice and the welfare of the small folk, inspired by his experiences squiring for Sir Duncan the Tall. Aegon implemented sweeping reforms aimed to improve the lives of common folk. These reforms granted rights and protections to the small folk, earning him their love and admiration.
There was starvation and suffering in the north, as there had been 100 years before in the long winter that reigned from 130 to 135 AC. King Aegon, always concerned for the welfare of the poor and weak, did what he could to increase the flow of grain and other food to the north, but some felt he did too much in this regard. His rule was also quickly tested by those whose affairs he had meddled in too often as a prince, attempting to reduce their rights and privileges.
Aegon's reforms, while created for the small folk, also brought upon conflict while it granted them less dominion over the peasantry. Despite the lacking of dragonback authority with his predecessors, Aegon presented within the just rule and instilled the rights to all of his subjects within the realm. Aegon V was never meant to be king, so far down the list of heirs that it was unlikely for him to inherit the throne.
Allow me to give my lord one last piece of counsel, the old man had said. The same counsel that I once gave my brother when we parted for the last time. He was 33 when the Great Council chose him to mount the Iron Throne, a man grown with sons of his own, yet in some ways still a boy. Aeg had an innocence to him, a sweetness we all loved. Kill the boy within you, I told him the day I took ship for the Wall. It takes a man to rule, an Aegon, not an egg. Kill the boy and let the man be born.
Therefore, he was dubbed Aegon the Unlikely. Because of conflict stirring up, he had to quash many a rebellion, and he had to send Brandon Rivers, known as Bloodraven, to the Night's Watch, as Brandon Rivers murdered Aerys Blackfyre. Another example of maintaining one's oath is Jon Snow, watching on the sidelines of how his own house falls and crumbles. Jon Snow's steadfast dedication to the Night's Watch, despite the pursuit of power.
My sword is pledged to the Night's Watch, Your Grace, Jon Snow answered carefully. That did not please the king. Stannis ground his teeth and said, I need more than a sword from you. Jon was lost. My lord, I need the North. The North?
and the weight of self-sacrifice embodies the honor of one's oath to the realm. He remains true to his vows, upholding the safety of one's realm of men. He remains true to his oath, maintaining the safety and stability of the realm. In the Dance of Dragons, Stannis Baratheon offers to legitimize Jon Snow as Jon Stark, Lord of Winterfell, in hopes that he would secure the North for him.
Your father was a man of honor. He was no friend to me, but I saw his worth. Your brother was a rebel and a traitor who meant to steal half my kingdom, but no man can question his courage. What of you?
Does he want me to say I love him? John's voice was stiff and formal as he said, I am a man of the Night's Watch.
Stannis Baratheon, the rightful king of the Iron Throne, needs to secure the North as he believes that he's Azor Ahai reborn. To secure Jon as Warden of the North would grant him fealty over the lands. This would also fulfill Jon's personal desires for identity and personal power, as well as navigating and avenging his own family's betrayal.
I need a son of Eddard Stark to win them to my banner. He would make me Lord of Winterfell.
Your Grace, he said, you forget. I am a Snow, not a Stark.
It's you who are forgetting, King Stannis replied.
Melisandre put a warm hand on Jon's arm.
A king can remove the taint of bastardy with a stroke, Lord Snow.
Lord Snow. But suddenly it had a different sound to it in Jon's ears. It sounded real.
However, Jon knows that this is his duty. His duty lies within the Night's Watch, and he declines Stannis' offer. Jon also shows accountability and leadership during the defending of the Wall amongst the Wildling invasion in A Storm of Swords and A Dance of Dragons when he realizes that the Wildlings are not the true threat to the realm, and it's actually the Others.
His name may not be spoken, Melisandre added softly. He is the god of night and terror, Jon Snow, and these shapes in the snow are his creatures.
Realizing that the pursuit of keeping the wildlings out will cause more harm than good, Jon Snow executes Janice Light for insubordination and a dispute, despite knowing that it would cause a disturbance amongst the Brotherhood of the Night's Watch. Jon's adherence to the principle of the orders must be fallen despite the maintaining of the status quo. Jon often got taken advantage of because he was the youngest commander of the Night's Watch. Because of this, it ultimately led to his death, paralleling with Ned Stark's death. As a Kingsguard member, Jaime swore a solemn oath to protect the king and uphold the honor of the realm.
The day he burned his mace and dagger hand, Jaime and John Derry had stood at guard outside her bedchamber whilst the king took his pleasure.
You're hurting me,
they had heard Rhaella cry through the oaken door.
You're hurting me.
In some queer way, that had been worse than Lord Chelsted screaming. We are sworn to protect her as well, Jamie had finally been driven to say.
We are, Derry allowed, but not from him.
Jamie had only seen Rhaella once after that, the morning of the day she left for Dragonstone.
However, during Robert's Rebellion, when the Lannisters began to sack King's Landing, Jaime found himself in an uncomfortable situation, facing a king that had gone mad, King Aerys II Targaryen, known as the Mad King, also with the conflict of the rebellion on the rise and his father at the gate. King Aerys ordered Jaime to kill his own father, because Tywin had betrayed him and had joined the rebellion. Jaime also witnessed firsthand the atrocities that were planned by Aerys, including the Order of the Wildfire caches hidden throughout the city. Jaime instead chose to kill Aerys, betraying his solemn oath. Although this sounds like a honorable thing, not allowing thousands to die, or allowing his own father to die at his hands, Jaime Lannister never warned anybody about the wildfire caches hidden throughout the cities, and still nobody knows about it in present-day Game of Thrones. Another thing to mention is that the war had been lost as soon as Rhaegar died on the Trident and Tywin began sacking King's Landing. There was no more hope for Aerys to win. Therefore, Jaime should have still honored his vow. Not killing his father and buying time for others to enter the throne room would have given him enough time to pledge his allegiance to Robert as the new king. Therefore, he would have never soiled his white cloak. Jaime's choice to kill Aerys Targaryen has later consequences throughout the series, as he's dubbed the Kingslayer, Oathbreaker, when he swore to protect Aerys out of every cost. Although Jaime has a redemption arc, it's still hard for me to see it, even with Ned's perspective.
My men were filling the room behind me. Lannister's men drew back. I never said a word. I looked at him, seated there on the throne, and I waited. At last, Jaime laughed and got up. He took off his helm, and he said to me, "Have no fear, Stark. I was only keeping it warm for our friend Robert."
Ned walks into the throne room and sees Jaime on top of the Iron Throne. Kill the king that you're sworn to protect and then sit upon the throne as his body is lying beneath you. Something cold and methodical about that. Another betrayal that cuts deep is Theon betraying the Stark family, forsaking his oath and loyalty to pursue a personal ambition, leading to drastic consequences for himself and others.
Am I your brother? Now and always.
Now and always.
My sword is yours, in victory and defeat, from this day until my last day.
The King of the North!
The King of the North!
These explore illustrations that prove the impact of oaths within Westeros, highlighting how those oaths or betrayals can shape the destiny of others lurking around throughout history. Raised as a warden of Winterfell after his father, Greylon Baejoy, failed at a rebellion, Theon, although accepted as a Stark, was not truly a Stark and strived to be one.
I did terrible things. Turned on Rob, captured Winterfell, killed those boys.
They weren't those boys, they were Bran and Rickon, they were your brothers. You've known them since they were born.
They weren't, they were only...
Only what?
I can't.
Tell me.
I can't, not unless the Master said...
Tell me, they weren't what?
They weren't.
Tell me why Bran and Rickon should be gone while you still breathe the air. Tell me to my face, Theon, tell me that they weren't your brothers.
They weren't Bran and Rickon.
They no longer saw him as an Ironborn, but rather a Stark. Within the books and the TV show, Theon is a morally gray character and wants to do what's best for his family. But in the end, he realizes that nothing will ever be good enough for his family because he wasn't raised as an Ironborn. He was raised as a Stark, and sadly, he'll never live up to his father's expectations from him because his father doesn't accept him no longer as a son of his. In the attempt to restore his identity and reclaim his place amongst the Ironborn, Theon betrays the Starks and seizes Winterfell when Robb is fighting for his own father's life. Once Robb becomes king in the North, Theon later betrays him, breaking the vows that he swore to protect the Starks and their family, forsaking them and taking Winterfell as his own, disregarding the hospitality and upbringing he received as their ward. Theon's betrayal ultimately leads to his downfall. An oath is a sacred bond that is upholded to the righteous decrees within Westeros. If your word could not be taken for as sheer fact or promise, then the world would be doomed within A Song of Ice and Fire. Lords of their vassals, known as wardens, are loyal not only to their family, but also the crown, making them be put in uncomfortable situations. Loyalty falls on their shoulders, whether to family or the crown. It underscores the embodiment of honor within Westeros. Family, duty, honor is the words of House Tully. The duty to uphold precedent and the realm underscores the fabric that is weaved through the bannermen of the Society of A Song of Ice and Fire. Ned Stark is a quintessential embodiment of loyalty and honor. His unwavering commitment to both his family and his duty to the crown serves as a pillarment of his character, ultimately shaping his fate and the tumultuous events within King's Landing.
Stannis looked disgusted. Your father was a stubborn man as well. Honor, he called it. Well, honor has its costs, as Lord Eddard learned to his sorrow.
Ned's primary ambition is the safety of his wife, Catelyn, and their children. His decisions are only influenced based on his perception on upholding honor. He instills the conflict of being hand and underscores the dangers of the South. He does this out of a sense of duty and honor to his old friend, King Robert Baratheon. Ned is also dedicated in the principles of the House Stark legacy. The values of House Stark stand as a testament, and this is evident in how he raises his kids, instilling the importance of honor, justice, and loyalty. As Hand, Ned uncovers the truth about the parentage of Queen Cersei's children. He's commanded to seek out justice, confronting the Queen about this discovery. His sense of duty to the crown and his honor drives him to the actions against the corruption he discovered.
And take him in hand, protector or no. The man who holds the king holds the kingdom. We should seize Myrcella and Tommen as well. Once we have our children, Cersei will not dare oppose us. The council will confirm you as Lord Protector and make Joffrey your ward.
Ned regarded him coldly. Robert is not dead yet. The guards may spare him. If not, I shall convene the council to hear his final words and consider the matter of the succession. But I will not dishonor his last hours on earth by shedding blood in his halls and dragging frightened children from their beds.
Even though it leads him to his downfall, Ned is able to see right from wrong in this situation. His duty to Robert is to tell him about the bastard children Cersei has had, but he also doesn't want the blood of children on his hands. Even when imprisoned and facing death, he maintains his sense of honor, ultimately confessing to treason only to protect his daughters. Ned's downfall is a direct result of his unwavering loyalty and honor.
You wear your honor like a suit of armor, Stark. You think it keeps you safe, but all it does is weigh you down and make it hard for you to move.
In the morally gray world of Westeros, his perception of black and white, of right and wrong, becomes a liability. His fate is sealed by the treacherous politics that Cersei and Peter Baelish play. His trusting too easily fails to recognize the deceit and lies that the Lannisters are willing to play. Ned Stark's foolproof sense of duty to both his family and the crown define his character, driving his actions, and his loyalty and his commitment to justice, while noble, ultimately led to his tragic end. Sir Barristan Selmy, another prominent figure that exemplifies the unwavering loyalty and decision-making to his oath, has also been a member of the Kingsguard. He served multiple Targaryen kings and later pledged himself to Daenerys Targaryen's cause. His steadfast commitment to his oaths highlight the notable honor and duty that is prominent in his character.
There was a time when he might have taken this dismissal as a blot upon his honor. But that was in Westeros. In the viper's pit that was Meereen, honor seemed as silly as a fool's motley. And this mistrust was mutual. His Dar Zolorek might be his queen's consort, but he would never be his king.
The idea of self-sacrifice and not being able to hold lands or bear children just to uphold the sacred oaths that he pledged his service to. Barristan's service began under King Jaehaerys II, where he earned the reputation of Barristan Selmy the Brave. His loyalty to Jaehaerys is marked by the decision of duty, underscoring the safety of a king and upholding the sacred values of the Kingsguard. Serving under the Mad King Aerys tests Barristan's loyalty. Despite Aerys' descent in madness and cruelty, Barristan remains steadfast in his duty. His loyalty to the crown is unwavering, even when his king becomes Robert during the rebellion. He fights nobly for the Targaryen cause, even when the Targaryens are rooted out and Robert becomes king, pledges himself to Robert's cause once more.
He was a knight of Westeros, a man of the Stormlands and the Dornish Marches. His place was in the Seven Kingdoms, not here upon the sweltering shores of Slaver's Bay. I came to bring Daenerys home. Yet he had lost her, just as he had lost her father and her brother. Even Robert, I failed him too.
When he becomes king. Despite the significant regime change, Barristan's sense of duty and loyalty to the crown still serves under Robert's reign. His loyalty to his office as king, rather than the individual, highlights his unwavering principle as being a king's guard. Barristan's loyalty is tested when he's dishonorably discharged from the Kingsguard by King Joffrey. Kingsguard are supposed to be served until death, and it does not matter upon age of when a Kingsguard can be dismissed. Rather, it's a vow to uphold the righteousness until they depart from this world. Viewing this as a gravest injustice, Barristan reforms his loyalty to the Targaryen line, seeking out Daenerys Targaryen. His decision to serve her is not only a personal one, but it also underscores the unwavering loyalty he has to the Targaryen family, and it also gives him a sense of honor. He's not only serving someone that he wants to be serving, but he's serving them out of the greater good of the realm. Under Daenerys, Barristan has become a trusted advisor and a protector. His loyalty to her is not just out of a condition of an oath, but rather a personal endeavor to see her safe and secure. Barristan chooses Daenerys because he sees the good within her, and he's able to serve her unwaveringly and committedly as a Kingsguard, but not only as a trusted advisor. Maegor Targaryen, known as Maegor the Cruel, ascended the Iron Throne through ruthless means, including the murder of his own nephew, Aegon the Uncrowned, and other kin.
Maegor, the first of his name, came to the throne after the sudden death of his brother, King Aenys, in the year 42 AC. He is better remembered as Maegor the Cruel, and it was a well-earned sobriquet, for no cooler king ever set the Iron Throne. His reign began with blood and ended in blood as well.
This betrayal of family underscores the tradition that he forsaked against the Targaryen rule. His lack of loyalty and kinship highlights the unwillingness that he would sacrifice his own blood for power.
The histories tell us he enjoyed war and battle, but it is clear that it was violence he most craved, violence and death, and absolute mastery over all he deemed his. What demon possessed him, none could say. Even today, some give thanks that his tyranny was a short one.
Maegor's rule was marked by charred actions and unseen customary values within the House Targaryen rule. Like Robert Baratheon and many others, Maegor the Cruel's rule was amongst fear and blood. Maegor's disregard to upheld the realm with a sense of honor and duty underscores the harsh tyrannical reign that is characterized with cruelty and death and despair. His cruel means underscore the use of Balerion the Black Dread and stealing a sense of fear and violence through his subjects. further illustrating his betrayal of the Targaryen legacy. His actions spark fear and chaos throughout the realm.
Maegor's tyrannical reign could no longer be borne, and the realm rose up to end it. Unifying them all was a claim put forward by the young prince Jaehaerys.
Similarly, Peter Baelish, known as Littlefinger, underscores the idea of loyalty to the ones who he can use and weaponize. His cunning and unwavering attempts to climb the ladder that is the realm.
If she should learn where I am, I might have to remove her from the game sooner than I'd planned, providing she does not remove herself first. Peter teased her with a little smile. In the Game of Thrones, even the humblest pieces can have wills of their own. Sometimes they refuse to make the moves you plan for them. Mark that well, Elaine. It's a lesson that Cersei Lannister still has yet to learn.
Shows how far Baelish will go to use his charm and wit to get the Iron Throne. His manipulation begins early on. Fans speculate that he was the catalyst for Robert's rebellion. Littlefinger's descent into power grants him betrayal after betrayal. He betrays Ned Stark, underscoring the catalyst that brings the faction of Lannister and Stark.
I did warn you not to trust me.
He also manipulates Lysa Arryn, believing that he's in love with her, and ultimately leads to not only her death, but also her husband's death. In this, he grants the veil and is able to also weaponize Sansa and other people in his political machinations. These are just a few examples of betrayed sense of loyalty, and a few examples of what loyalty truly looks like to those who have a sense of honor and justice. In the intricate and often treacherous world of A Song in Ice and Fire, honor is renowned as a guiding light, though even the strongest are tested through the darker of the machinations of politics. Many fail, many fall, when they try to grab the social ladder that is known as the chaos.
Follow us all. Chaos isn't a pit. Chaos is a ladder. Many who try to climb it fail.
Many seek out power, justice, identity, and many fail. But within the world, virtues are upheld to the fabric of the society, where stories tell the deeper roots of laws, customs, traditions, and oaths. Nobilities are punished with a sense of honor and justice, to uphold the paramount of the crown. Ultimately, the contrast between those paramount of virtues and agencies of corruption underscore the profound impact of justice, duty, oaths, and loyalty, having a fate upon the realm of Westeros. As we reflect on their legacies, it becomes clear that the essence of honor is not mere a relic of the past, but a guiding force that shapes the realm of destiny within the people of A Song of Ice and Fire. The struggle between maintaining honor and the stability of corruption underscores the idea and narrative within Westeros, revealing to us that the conflicting between good and evil is evident now more than ever, and the pursuit of honor is timeless within Westeros.